It's not always easy to save money on home insurance. Plus, it's complicated to even think about. We get it. But switching your home insurance doesn't have to be a headache. You can save money and time with Allstate.
Check Allstate first and you could save $574 on your home insurance. No hassle, just savings. You're in good hands with Allstate.
Not available in every state based on the national average annual savings for new home insurance customers surveyed in 2023 who switched to Allstate and reported savings. Savings vary.
Lumen is the world's first handheld metabolic coach. It's a device that measures your metabolism through your breath. And on the app, it lets you know if you're burning fat or carbs and gives you tailored guidance to improve your nutrition, workout, sleep, and even stress management.
All you have to do is breathe into your Lumen first thing in the morning, and you'll know what's going on with your metabolism, whether you're burning mostly fats or carbs. Then Lumen gives you a personalized nutrition plan for that day based on your measurements. You can also breathe into it before and after workouts and meals, so you know exactly what's going on in your body in real time. And Lumen will give you tips to keep you on top of your health game.
Being healthy is handsome, and your metabolism is a huge factor in your overall health. In fact, metabolism is at the center of everything your body does, and taking care of your metabolism can translate into improved energy, higher sleep quality, and better management of hormonal shifts. So if you want to take the next step in improving your health, go to lumen.me/handsome to get 15% off your Lumen. That's lumen.me/handsome for 15% off your purchase. Thank you, Lumen, for sponsoring this episode.
Handsome, chatting with friends on the handsome pod. Chatting with friends on the handsome pod.
Cheers.
Welcome to another episode of the Handsome Pod. I am Mae Martin, of course, and I'm joined by the beautifully handsome...
Oh, that's me. Tig Notaro.
And Fortune Feimster.
Tig, you're lit in the sort of dappled evening sunlight.
Yes, I am. I'm in my apartment in Toronto, and I have kind of limited options of where I can sit and record. And so this is what happens, especially after 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Then I get sunlight on my face.
That's good. Because you don't want to film in front of your Ponties.
In front of my Ponties. What do you mean?
Like, are they probably just strewn about?
Just out of frame. Everywhere is covered with Ponties.
Yeah. I mean, would you imagine that my apartment's a mess?
No, I imagine you're very tidy.
I'm pretty tidy.
Just like your whiteies, tidy whiteies.
I do have a few pile up areas in my life and in my house and stuff where I'm like, I got to get through this.
Yeah.
Stephanie's on a major minimalist tear.
Oh, really? She's just like donating things and throwing things away. And
I mean, she is just like went through her books, was like so attached to them. And then now she's like, do I need all of my books? Am I going to go back and read these? Am I going to, you know, so she's at a bit of a fork in the road right now.
Oh my God.
But this is, I'm really enjoying this new side of her where she's just on this tear.
I'm excited for the phase where she's running around to charity shops trying to get her stuff back.
Oops.
I missed that book. And then it's in May's bookshelf.
What about the two of you? Are you tidy or are you...
No, I'm a mess, man. But I'm not dirty. Like, I don't leave plates and food around, but clothes mm-hmm. everywhere. And because I'm like filming and then I run back home and I'll sleep for 5 hours and go film again. So I just throw stuff around.
Mm-hmm. You all too, week. Fortune?
I'm not like messy. I'm not as clean as like Jax, but I, mm-hmm. I'll have like a little bit of stuff start to pile up and then I'm like, okay, I got to get everything in its place. So I'm not crazy, but I'm not also not the one scrubbing things down.
I got a lot of weights around right now. I keep like impulsively buying bigger and bigger weights that I can't lift yet. And these poor Amazon delivery guys are like lugging these weights to my house. And then I don't know what I'm going to do when I have to leave Toronto. I'm just going to, I don't know, donate the weights, I guess.
Well, you could bring them home in a suitcase as long as they're not over 50 pounds, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are you buying? What's the highest amount
50, yeah. Actually.
Oh, 50.
I have a 50.
Oh, perfect.
Like
one suitcase.
Yeah, 250s. Yeah. I've been trying to, all week I've been filming this one fight sequence where, do you know the comedian Mark McKinney from Kids in the Hall?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I cast him. I used to babysit for him when I was 13. And it's this weird full circle moment where we have this vicious fight and he tases me over and over. Oh. This is spoilers, but whatever. It was so embarrassing acting like you're being tased when you're not. I had to really. And you have to stop yourself making a sound effect like that.
Oh, right. I guess that would be really a huge challenge.
Yeah, for me.
And so can you give us a little bit of a look of what you tased without making the noise would look
yes.
like?
Okay, because I watched videos online of what people look like.
I'm going to tase you right now.
Okay, ready? One, two, three.
Oh, look at that facial expression.
Yeah, I almost shit myself.
Just now?
No, like we were doing
squeezing
it
so hard
day, just tensing and tensing. And
have you ever been tased?
No, but did you know in LA at some haunted houses, you sign a release form and they're allowed mm-hmm. to tase you?
No.
What, just in a spooky way?
Yeah. No,
sounds like in a real way.
In a real way, like there's the...
But like to scare you or... Why are you signing a release to be tased?
It's a great question, Tig.
Thank you.
There's a place called like Horror Hotel or something that's all these escape rooms. And at Halloween, they open all the doors, they turn off all the lights, and you go in there and you have to sign a form of whether you can get tased. And there's monsters going around, and if they catch you, they can tase you.
No. Why do people pay for this crazy stuff?
And you sign a release saying, sure, tase me?
Well, in LA, I've never done it, but in LA, some of these like horror, you know, Halloween events, you can, it must be like a low charge tase or something, because that feels so
yeah,
dangerous.
It can't be like a hardcore one.
Yeah.
Because that could like really F somebody up.
It could F someone right up.
Mm-hmm. Haunted houses, I'll do them if like my friends are all going and I don't want to be left out, but they scare me.
And yeah. How often are all of your friends going to a haunted house?
They're in Halloween time is around the corner. Mm-hmm. All this stuff will be appearing right around now.
Do you get yourself a spooky pumpkin latte? Or
I like that. I like a latte. Uh-huh. That's my kind of Halloween.
Yeah.
I don't do the pumpkin spice as much, mm-hmm. but I don't mind a sip of coffee by a fire pit.
Tig, no. Would you like a haunted house? Like, do you enjoy being jump scares?
No, no, absolutely not. And I scare Stephanie all day long.
Yeah.
Accidentally in our home.
Oh, because you're quiet and she's like bells on your feet.
Yeah, she's just I don't know if I told you, but she. Well, she feels like I shuffle too quietly on purpose. I don't know if I told you this, but she accused me of... I said that at the live show. Is that right?
Oh, I think you said on one pod that she wanted to put bells on your feet or mm-hmm. something like that.
I don't know what... But she did I tell you she's accused me of doing it on purpose?
No, I don't know if I knew that. Yeah, that's another...
Okay. Yeah, yeah. She was like, I feel like you have decided to try to scare me. Like, this is something you are doing. And I was like, I am a busy 53-year-old person.
Yeah.
I'm not a psychopath walking around trying to scare people in my own home or anywhere, really.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I would love to work in a haunted house and be the one scaring. That would be really fun, I think.
Well, sure. You're in a haunted house. That's the world.
Yeah.
But like just out in life or in your own home, like a grown human being, like, like I'm not trying to do that to her.
Mm-hmm. I do like to do that on purpose sometimes.
And you do too, Fortune?
Mm-mm.
No, you don't?
Mm-mm. Mm-mm. I'm not a prank gal.
I remember at school, the big prank was they would put cellophane over the toilet seat. Mm-hmm. So then, and then when you pee, mm-hmm. well, you can imagine. I can imagine.
What happens?
So, Fortune, you don't like to do pranks and you don't like pranks done to you.
Exactly.
I made a new friend the other day and we were talking about pranks.
Congrats.
And he said that, so he has a long-term friend and he went over to her house and he wore fake eyelashes. And she was like, what is, you look different. He was like, no, what are you talking about? And he gaslit her so hard that she was like almost crying. She was like, "You're something is different." And he was like, I don't know what's wrong with you. And then finally he was like, all right, I'm
wearing. She was almost crying?
Yeah.
And so Fortune, if I showed up to the live show and I had fake eyelashes on,
well,
would
that's
you be
a
like,
prank that doesn't like, that's whatever. That's just you doing something to yourself.
Okay. Well, no, I'd be doing it to other people too. I mean,
and to get in your head, Fortune.
Yeah, yeah, but I would, if you were like, no, I would just like, okay.
And so what
it's
is,
not, it's not that deep for me.
What's the depth where you're like, hard pass, weirdo, step back?
If someone's like if I had been part of like the show Punked or something, I would not have enjoyed that.
Right, because those used to get extreme. It would be like they would,
yeah,
they would like smash someone's car.
Yeah, I'm not into that.
Yeah, you're not.
Okay.
You know, filming you in your most vulnerable time, making you believe something awful just happened.
Yeah.
Well, what about you know, when I did that thing where I sang at a party Adele's song when Adele was at the party? I mean,
that would be funny to me.
Wait. Have you guys talked about this on a minisode or something?
No, on Tig Special, the end of Tig Special.
Yeah. Oh my God. Tell it again quickly.
Quick, yeah, Tig quickly.
Real quick. Okay.
I was at a party that was littered with a lot of celebrities. And,
yeah.
And throughout the night, there were different singers and musicians getting on stage because there was a full, like, there were instruments, grand piano, microphones, everything on stage. So people could just get up and sing a few songs and then get down. Somebody else would get up.
Yeah.
The whole night you saw the biggest names
that
of
would
forever.
Be cool.
And Adele was at the party and the whole vibe, the whole night, no matter who was singing or playing, everybody was like, here comes Adele. I think Adele's going to perform next. Here she comes. Oh my God. There's
oh my
Adele.
God.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
She's like,
it was truly like a vibe all about Adele. And I'm talking every massive star was there performing. And yeah, then she never sang.
Oh.
And so
that would be a bummer.
Yeah. So I turned, and it was just a casual night of people getting up and singing. And
yeah.
And then I said to Stephanie, I was like, and I mean, like Oprah Winfrey was at the, everybody
oh my
was there.
God.
Okay. And I said to Stephanie, I was like, I'll go sing.
Oh and, my God.
And then, I can't sing. And so I got, Pink was there and I asked Pink, I said, will you go tell the DJ to, Pink had just sang songs.
Okay.
And when she got down, I said, hey, can you go ask the DJ to play Adele's Hello?
Oh my God.
And she was like, yeah. Cause I was like, I'm going to sing. And she was like, Pink was all excited. And, so she went over, asked the DJ to play Adele's Hello. And I sat at the grand piano and I sang along to Adele's Hello, like at the top of my lungs, the best I could. And it was the worst rendition Adele's Hello. And so that was, I guess that would be a prank, right?
Yeah, that counts.
Yeah, but that, it's funny to me.
Did Adele laugh?
Well, that's the thing is it was, I don't know where Adele was in that exact moment because there were a lot of people there.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, everybody else was there
yeah.
and saw that.
She's outside smoking a cig. Like, what is this madness?
I mean, love that.
Truly.
It's way funnier and better that you tried your best. Like you really belted it out. Like,
I really did. I did it like commit. I was in my car by myself,
yeah,
just singing. And I know my voice goes off the rails like crazy. And so I was just like, I'm going to go for it. And I don't care.
Did you look up and see if any like big celebrity was there watching? Like,
Well, it was like a stage with lighting, you know, okay. Was it just somebody's living room? And gotcha. But I have footage of Pink doubled over choking to get
as long as Pink enjoyed it. That's all I care about.
Yeah. It was really fun.
I would like to
make Pink laugh. Yeah. She seems fucking cool.
Yeah. She's Pink, awesome. Her voice.
It's so good.
It's ridiculous.
Mm. Yeah. Oh, when she and Kelly Clarkson sang together on Kelly Clarkson's show, they did like a 10-minute medley of Pink songs, but acoustically. Mm-hmm. I think I've listened to that 1,000 times.
I'll have to check that out.
Oh, it's so good. They just did snippets of like 5 songs.
Uh-huh.
And
did each song like meld into the next one kind of like?
No, they would do like a one for like 2 minutes and then stop and then, then do another one. But like, as you know, Kelly Clarkson's voice is one of my favorites of all time. And then Pink's voice is amazing. And then they're harmonizing together. It was like my brain was exploding.
Mm-hmm. I love a good harmony.
Oh, I love a good harmony.
Yeah. Myself. Love a good harmony.
Yeah.
I love a terrible harmony.
Yeah.
That's enjoyable in a whole other way.
Yeah. Handsome homeowners, we know you love a good deal and we know you want the best home insurance you can possibly get. Well, you can save and get a great policy by switching to Allstate today.
Check Allstate first and you could save $574 on your home insurance. No hassle, just savings. You're in good hands with Allstate.
Not available in every state based on the national average annual savings for new home insurance customers surveyed in 2023 who switched to Allstate and reported savings. Savings vary.
But just those two, because they're the type of singers that could sing anyone's song amazingly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And do.
Mm-hmm. You know what I love? Brother-sister harmony. Like, Rufus Wainwright and Martha Wainwright singing One Man Guy, which is their dad's song. You know what I'm talking about, Dave?
Absolutely,
the best.
Absolutely. That whole family is so off the charts.
Yeah.
So Martha Wainwright is the biggest rock star in the world. I mean, her voice is...
it's crazy.
Her vibe, everything... Yeah.
I've seen her live so many times. Whenever she's playing and I'm nearby, mm-hmm. I make sure I go. And I learned to kind of, I was like, I think I got to go by myself because I want to just focus. And I went on a date once. Someone I was dating flew to England to visit me. And I took her to the Martha Wainwright concert. And then she started feeling nauseous, like food poisoning. I should have taken her home. I stayed. And she went back
in the bathroom.
To the hotel.
Well, Martha Wainwright was singing, right?
Yeah. I've never seen Martha Wainwright perform.
You got to look up Martha Wainwright.
Oh,
Martha
Jesus.
Wainwright is just... a rock star. That is all I can say about this woman.
Song, Bloody Motherfucking Asshole.
No. Mm-hmm.
Unreal.
Yeah.
I don't know this.
Everyone drop what you're doing. Become the biggest fan of Martha Wainwright.
I actually just listened to her audiobook. She wrote an autobiography. It was electric. But I actually, you know how I had my moment with Justin Trudeau where I said, your legacy will be great. Mm-hmm. I had that moment with Martha Wainwright, a similar thing where she was just playing an intimate show in LA. And I happened to be friends with the guy drumming for her. And so I was like, this is my in. And afterwards, I'm kind of standing with him having a cigarette outside or something. And she's there. And I think she asked for a cigarette or something. And then I go, you're at the top of your game. I go, I just got to say, you are at the top of your game. She was like, okay.
She was like, did she say,
what about my legacy?
Yeah.
Well, your legacy will also be great.
To blow your mind, I'm friends with Martha Wainwright.
Can you tell her I love her?
Yes.
How funny that you love this person so much and takes friends with them.
This happens a lot, though. Lucy Lawless.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You guys know people, you know?
Yeah.
You know people.
And they're random.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, and specific.
Yeah. They're very random. Like, yes, I'm friends with Lucy Lawless.
And Martha Wainwright.
But
that, for some reason, it's my niche obsession.
I know,
too,
right?
Yeah.
I just love that you started this with, I love a brother-sister duo.
I do.
I'm trying to think of other brother-sister
singers. I can't think of a single one.
Well, and within the Wainwright family, there's just numerous brother-sister duos just round and around. I mean, and this, their sister, Lucy.
There's more than just the two of them.
Rufus.
I know Rufus, obviously.
Yeah. They should have like a reality show.
Can you imagine? It would be really sort of poetic, I think. Like, it wouldn't be like the Kardashians. It would be like, someone's having a glass of red wine.
You know what's so funny is I just laughed so hard saying, no, it would not be like the Kardashians. I've never seen the Kardashians.
What?
I have never seen that show.
Are you serious?
I can gather what the show is.
What it would be?
Yes.
Let me tell you, you're missing out.
Yeah. Like, whatever you think it is, I will tell you it's better because they are so compelling and very funny. And this is weird. That was like the first. I know there must have been. There was the Osbournes.
The Osbournes were first. Yeah.
Yeah. But with,
what do you mean they were the Osbournes were first?
As far as like this trend of families on reality television.
Yeah. Mm. Where like all of America just felt like they knew that family. And like you wanted
Kardashians
to keep up.
What, 20 keep years up now on TV or something?
Are they still going?
Yeah, but now they're on Hulu. There's just so many of them. You don't run out of storylines.
Yeah.
But I want to go back and clarify just so I'm not lying to anybody. Mm-hmm. Martha Wainwright is not a close friend of mine.
For sure. Okay. For sure. Yes. But if you saw each other, you'd go, hey. That.
Yes, I'm close with Rufus and his husband, Yorn. And so I...
Another fun name.
Yes. And
Yorn.
Martha, you're like, we're friends, but like...
Well, like, I see her at Rufus things, and I'm just, I'm very beside myself, always like, oh my God, that is the biggest rock star alive.
I gotta watch her stuff.
Really, go look at videos, go buy her stuff, go see her live.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All of them, all of those Wainwrights. I mean, how did this turn into the Wainwright show? But... They're all freakishly talented.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we talked about this because of brother sisters.
Brother sisters. The carpenters weren't brother sisters, were they?
Yes, they were.
Yeah, they were.
Oh, there you go. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And you got then the Bee Gees. There must be some, I mean, brothers, but there must be something in when you share DNA, your voices just meld.
Billie Eilish and Phineas.
Oh, yeah.
True.
They're making incredible music together.
Incredible.
They're really cool to watch behind the scenes, how they create their songs and stuff. He's like such a genius producer. And then she has this like such a specific vision of what she wants the song to be. It's really cool to see two people and at their age just doing this like prolific songwriting.
And then meanwhile, their mom, Maggie, is like from the Groundlings. Mm-hmm. And she,
really?
Yeah, she comes from the comedy world. And she's
taught improv for years.
That's crazy. And Phoebe Bridgers' mom does stand up. Yeah,
she does?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So who knows? Maybe one day we'll have kids who are amazing musicians.
Well, my sons, they started their own little band together.
No.
Yeah.
Stop it.
Didn't I tell you that Max wrote a new song?
No.
Didn't you say there was a song that we couldn't, you didn't want to play it on the pod, but that
you're thinking of the song that came up during you were watching a sports game.
Yeah, and we were watching the Super Bowl.
Right.
Max wrote a new song called what is it? Something about down by the shoreline. Walk with me down by the shoreline. And a friend of ours asked him if he had heard of Morrissey or the Smiths. And he said no. And she played Morrissey and the Smiths for him. He went back and revisited his song and sang it just like Morrissey.
Oh my God.
Just like Morrissey.
Please, please, please.
Walk with me down by the shoreline. Down by the shoreline.
Oh my
down
God.
Down by the shoreline. I mean, I couldn't believe it.
That's
I could
incredible.
Not. It's such a hit song. May I have to send it to you?
Please do.
It is such a number one hit song.
And just so you know, I am still working on the cover of the original Exercise. I'm telling you, I've laid down the instrumentals. I just got to do the vocals.
It's a work in progress.
Well, I think you're going to jump ahead to Down by the Shoreline.
Yeah, you got to get this on iTunes stat.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is a true, like his first song, he's written many songs, but the one during the Super Bowl, We Don't Know How This World Works.
Yeah.
That's his first song.
Deep.
Yeah. His new one.
The sun rises west. The sun goes down east. We don't know how the world works. We don't know how the world began.
Begin.
It had, we can't feel the world was the line that really blew my mind.
Yeah. And now there's just down by the shoreline. It's so good. Okay, we can move on.
Y'all are way cooler than me with music. I never listened to Morrissey either.
I didn't know Jimmy Buffett, so.
I mean, that's true.
I didn't know Joe the Button Maker.
We're all teaching
clean
each other something.
Yeah. Speaking of Joe, just to quickly touch back on, in a previous episode, I mentioned the Bear video. I read a poem. Now watched the Bear video.
Did you make it through all the
video? Wait, what is the Bear video?
Remember when May was so nervous about watching their
video? Yes.
To recap, I have this driver at work. He says, I got this video of 12 men wrestling a bear in a bar. So anyway, it grew in my head like a weed. I've become obsessed with, like, why is this coming to my life? I'm scared to watch it. Once I see it, I can't unsee it. Like,
point where you wrote a giant poem.
I wrote a poem.
Poem.
I go into my trailer one day and the TV in my trailer is on and just a blue screen, and there's like an old VCR plugged into it, and Joe has set up for me and he's got the VHS there. It says Caesar the Wrestling Bear.
This is a whole thing.
Yeah, man. And I'm like, okay, this is the moment. Like, I got to watch it. And I watched it. I don't even know really where to start. Like, it was incredible. Yeah, I'm worried about the bear for sure, but the bear seemed... It was this 900-pound bear in a bar in 1993. Everyone has a mullet in the bar, and they're all...
Even
the bear. Okay. Shaved except for
Joe
a mullet.
Joe Dirt.
And one by one, they're getting up to... And they're very respectful to the bear. They kind of pet it first, and then they wrestle it, and...
Sorry. If you have a bear in a bar...
Oh, it's not good.
You've already not been respectful to the
bear. Of course. I think the bear was, and for anyone listening, listen, I'm with you. Like, don't have a bear in a bar wrestling people. But they'd rescued it as a cub from a circus or something. Anyway, it has all its teeth and claws. Like, it is a
don't
full...
worry, we'll get you out of this circus. We'll bring you to a bar. We're going to save you.
But I'm like, what was I meant to learn from the bear video? Because what struck me was the bear... knew not to hurt people. They were like flies to it. Like, it would just swat them with one paw and then pin them on the ground, and then it would start licking them like a puppy. It was like playing. And meanwhile, and guy after guy trying their best, and it was pretty incredible. And my question going into it was like, am I the kept bear? Like, is this meant to be showing me? And maybe it is. Maybe I don't know my own power. You know what I mean? Anyway, so none of us know my power.
None of us know our own power.
I know. And then so afterwards, Joe got another job and just sort of vanishes. It's like he came into my life.
He's no longer just
to show me this video, you know, and
this mystical video. But it feels like there was a lot of buildup for the bear, build a bear, if you will.
It did not disappoint. It built a bear very good.
And then it just kind of was like, oh, okay.
No, sorry. Then I've told it wrong.
Okay.
It was not, it was, this is one of the most insane and incredible things I've ever seen in my life, and bizarre and like emotional. Afterwards I said, Joe, I don't know what to say. Like, and he said, oh, something to see, isn't it? I said, yeah, it is. Yeah, it is something to see. I will say that since I watched the bear video, my life fell apart. So I may be cursed by the bear video. But we'll see.
Things come apart. They come back together. The life,
The beautiful, rich history.
A lot of corners around this life we're living.
Some bad things have to happen for good things to happen. Like that one episode you talked about.
About the farmer and the horses. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
big time. But maybe. Anyway, the bear video, I have closure on the bear video, and I'm glad I saw it. And thank you to Joe.
Thank you, Joe.
Namaste. Namaste.
Should we check in and see what our questioner, who our questioner is? What our question is?
Yes. Can I introduce it because I'm so excited?
Yes, please.
Please.
That's not to say we're not excited.
Oh, we're just so excited.
You just barreled right in.
I am a huge fan of this person. The fact that she might know that I exist is huge. Today's questioner is an actress and comedian known for her 7 years on SNL, as well as TV shows like 30 Rock and movies like Wine Country. She was nominated for a Tony Award for her role in the Broadway play POTUS. Rachel Dratch is asking today's question.
Nice.
Hello, handsome. It's Rachel Dratch here. I'm going to blurt this out because this is like my 85th take of trying to do this. I know, it's unbelievable. But anyway, here's my question. What was your favorite thing about growing up in your hometown? How did it shape you? What did you love about it? Or your home state, I guess. And if you didn't love it, what was your least favorite thing? But I was trying to keep it positive. So what was your favorite thing about growing up where you did? There, I did it. Okay. Signing off.
She don't want to be a Debbie Downer.
I was just going to say that. One of my go-to YouTube things.
Might be one of her greatest sketches of all time.
Debbie Downer and the way it would zoom in on her face and she would be trying not to laugh.
The one video where, was it Fallon Lindsay Lohan. And Lindsay Lohan, they couldn't stop laughing the whole time.
Oh, man.
She's a silly person.
She just cracks me up, man. Some people just have funny bones.
That whole era of SNL women just were beyond.
Yes. That was your era too, right? Fortunately, like that's what I was watching.
Yes, that would have been Poehler and Tina Fey and Anna Gasteyer.
Yes.
So am I leaving anyone else? Molly Shannon.
Sherry O'Terry and Molly Shannon.
Right behind them, I think.
Yeah.
Right?
Belushi.
Aykroyd.
I mean, just
Aykroyd's big.
Those
moment.
Ladies did like definitely make you want to do comedy and would make you want to be silly and stuff because they just seemed to have fun doing it.
Mm. Yeah, and for me, like in middle school, like I was like, I can't pull off what some of the girls in my class are pulling off. Like, I don't know how to be cool. And so it was like amazing seeing how powerful it was to be silly, like that and how that's so much cooler than trying to be cool. Like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm also just remembering that I met Rachel Dratch has a brother who is a comedy writer and producer.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Do they ever sing together? Do they ever
harm? I don't know. That's a good question. I'm forgetting his name.
So you've met Rachel?
I have not. I don't think.
Yeah, I don't think I've met Rachel either.
One of those people I've seen 10 billion times on TV. And then, of course, I could believe we've met, but I'd also believe we've met.
You feel like you know her.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I feel like we talk a lot about our hometowns on the show. Like, you guys have more hometown towns because they're small towns, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so my hometown is Belmont, North Carolina. It's 30 minutes outside of Charlotte, North Carolina, and we're just on the other side of the airport. So I'm actually closer to the Charlotte airport than some of Charlotte. But it's a tiny town of, when I was born, it was about 8,000 people. Man. Now it's a booming metropolis of about 12,000 people.
Whoa.
And every time I go home, it is exploding with new homes and new apartment buildings. And the whole town's going to implode at some point because it cannot handle the amount of people trying to move into it.
Did it feel small when you were growing up? It did?
Very small because, it was tiny and everyone knew each other. Now, there's more people now that I don't know, but I've also been gone for so long. But it was a very sleepy little town and very boring when I was growing up. No fancy restaurants, no good restaurant. Kind of drying up, to be honest. And then it had this whole revitalization. And now it's like one of the sought out places to live in North Carolina.
Would you ever move back there?
I mean, no. I wouldn't mind it at this point in my life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a really cute, it's so cute. When I go home now, I'm like, God, my hometown is awesome. Mm-hmm. And I always loved it because of the people. Growing up, I was bored out of my mind and I couldn't wait to leave.
Okay. This is what I'm interested in. Yeah. Like, so you felt claustrophobic.
Oh yeah. I felt like there's gotta be more to life. This is so boring. When I was in high school, you just drove up and down this one street. you would like, the kids would hang out in the church parking lot. There was nothing to do, nowhere to go. We weren't allowed to really hang out in Charlotte. It was too much of the big city. and so, yeah, I just couldn't wait to peace out. But the thing I always loved about my hometown is that the people were so nice and so lovely and supportive. And I'm five generations of that hometown, so my family goes way back there.
Five generations is a lot. That takes you back to like 1900 or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but my mom lives there and I go visit, and my dad actually just moved back. He moved away, but I love it for them because what I miss in LA is not having, I don't feel like I have a community here. I kind of feel like I have friends and stuff, but we all live in different places, but I just feel like in my hometown, everyone's kind of looking out for each other. Mm-hmm. And my mom just had knee surgery and tons of people every day were bringing her food or taking her to a physical therapy or checking on her. Like it's so cool how, you know, if something happens to someone, everyone descends upon that place. So what do you need? What can I do? Like checking on people. It's just a very neat way of just being there for each other. I'm glad my parents have that.
Yeah.
That is real nice.
Mm-hmm. Do you have does the town have inside jokes as a town? That was a weird question. I mean, specific weird traditions and stuff.
I mean, the big thing, at least when I was growing up, was the Friday night football game at the high school. Like half the town went, you know?
Yeah.
That was a big thing. And then everyone goes to church. That's a huge part of the South, and especially a small town. You know that everyone's going to be at church on Sunday and they're all going to be... Well, it used to be when I was growing up, there was only so many restaurants that were decent. And so you wanted to be the first one to get out of church so you could beat the Baptist to the, you know, place. And everyone was vying for the tables. So it was, that was how exciting it got. But yeah, very quaint, very small town, but a place that instilled manners in me and, you know, that you just kind of, like I said, looked out for each other. It wasn't a very selfish place. A lot of community was happening there.
Tig, you were small town as well. And I always think about small towns and would worry, like, if you mess up once or you do something wrong, like, you can't really escape it. Like, it stays with you and you're...
That does happen.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, my hometown in Mississippi... Generations of my family live there as well, and I have extended family still there. But we also moved to an area outside of Houston, and we moved around a bit as a kid. But yeah, my town, God, I think it's like 5,000 people, maybe.
Really? Jeez Louise.
Yeah, it's not.
It's hard it's hard to underage drink in a town that small,
no,
right?
No, it's not.
They do that.
It's not. Real easy.
It's like in the basement of someone's house, or
or anywhere. Like I don't know. I just feel like that is not really policed too much.
Okay. Fave thing?
Well, I mean, I would say that. I have all of these older cousins that kind of, there's four boys that are like, I don't know, 10 to somewhere in the 9 to 15 years
feet
older
tall.
Than me and my brother. Yeah, 9 to 15 feet tall. No, they're older cousins that they were like brothers to me and my brother. And yeah. they were between us and my mother. So they were like younger brothers to my mother and then like older brothers to me and my brother. And they just were so fun to be yeah. with and took us to do cool things all the time, whether it was just going to the beach or going, like I remember just riding around in the back of a pickup truck, just something as simple as that, that I loved so much, where of course, not terribly safe. And I wouldn't want my kids riding around in the back of a pickup truck.
Those were different times. No helmets, yeah. no seatbelts.
Like, drinking out of a bottle, like, you know, yeah. just in the back, just sliding around in the back of a yeah. pickup truck.
Going to wrestle a bear.
I was always in the back of a pickup back yeah. in the day.
Really?
And the, mm-hmm. yeah. And like boating and water skiing. I mean, I think I've told you guys we'd water ski in swamps and people are like, no way. And I would have to call my brother and be like, am I making this up? but I think that, yeah, it's that sense of community and everybody knowing each other. And anytime my town's really close to New Orleans and right over the border of Louisiana and Mississippi. And, mm-hmm. and I mean, if I'm ever working in New Orleans and then I just drive in to see my family, I'll stop to get a coffee or something. And inevitably one of my cousins will call and be like, hey, I heard you're down at the coffee yeah, shop.
Yeah, that's the same when I go to
town. Yeah,
same really? When I go home. Like every yeah. It's like it goes through the grapevine, like right yeah. away.
Every yeah. immediately, or like I remember, you know, walking with Stephanie down the beach and just honks at us, and I'm like, hey, you know, just yeah. it's you can't hide there at all. Mm-hmm. But coming back with my family now, we go back all the time. Probably a couple of times, I mean, two or three times a year. And I love bringing my wife and children everywhere and into all of the shops. And everybody knows us. Everybody loves them.
Oh, man.
And it's just the greatest feeling. And that's why I love where we live in Los Angeles. It's like a small town feeling. It has a little, you know, it has a lot of little shops and cafes, and it's all walkable. And I love that for Max and Finn because it reminds me of my town yeah. in Mississippi, because you walk into a place, they know your order, they know your name, they, mm-hmm. you know, they haven't seen you in a while. What's going on and where have you been and how are you feeling and how are the kids? Yeah. And I just like that. You
triple
know?
Shot decaf coffee.
Quad shot.
Yeah. Yeah. But I like, this is so nice because I feel like there's a stigma around especially small towns in the South and the mm-hmm. States. And it's so mm-hmm. nice to hear that like you guys love your hometowns and go back and are so welcome there. And that's
yeah.
amazing.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
I think it's important to remember that things are not that black and white that totally. You, I mean, it sure can be, but yeah. not everybody in the South and not everybody in small towns and not everyone where you think they're going to be this, that way or the other. It's just not always what you think. And you have to mm-hmm. give people more credit and understand that whatever people or places don't represent everybody.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
What about you with your tiny town?
With Toronto? I mean, yeah, I grew up in a big city but Toronto does have kind of anytime I meet someone from Toronto, the first question is what high school did you go to? Mm. And it feels kind of small towny and you always have mutual friends. But for better or worse, as a teen, I loved how anonymous it was. I loved being able to get on the subway and go yeah. and no one knew where the hell I was. And I would run around and I loved how busy it was. And I loved, I'm pretty town proud. I have a mm-hmm. tattoo of 416. That's like the Toronto area code. But then Drake got really into 416 and saying and kind of co-opted 416 as a thing. But
is he from here?
He's from Toronto. He went, mm-hmm. of course, went to high school with my friend and they were in a production of Les Mis. And
okay.
like everyone. Yeah. Like, yeah, there's a shared kind of vocabulary. I hate how cold it got in the winter.
Oh, yeah.
Like that visceral feeling of like the salt that people throw on the, you know, to get the salt stains on your jeans and your winter boots, and you'd have to bring your shoes in a backpack, you know.
Yeah, I would not like that.
Oh, man, it got so cold. But summer in Canada is pretty dreamy. Lakes and
When does it start to get cold? I always forget when it starts to get cold again.
Well, it depends on global warming, but
three weeks, right?
Like on Halloween, you'd wear a winter coat over your costume, you know?
Yeah.
And your winter boots.
Yeah, it's coming for us.
But it never felt like overwhelming being a bigger place. Like that never kind of bothered you just because it's what you're used to.
Yeah. I mean, if I imagine my own family, I'm like, a small town would be great. So I see the benefit, because I definitely ran wild, and you know what I mean? But I loved it. Yeah. But it is like I'm working with a Canadian crew now and Canadian cast, and it's such a small, like my friend Gabby came to visit set, and we're walking around, and then the woman doing hair goes, "Oh my God, Gabby." And she used to do Gabby's hair when Gabby was 17, and like she worked at like a salon, and just and then like my co-star was like, "Oh yeah, I did the just niche things." She's like, "I did square dancing at the Royal Winter Fair as part of Kiwanis." This combination of words is so familiar to me. I'm like, yep, I was probably there. Like,
that's funny.
Yeah. The Royal Winter Fair. Yeah. For sure. Yeah.
I mean, there definitely were drawbacks of a small town, whereas it's really awesome to have that community. It was weird growing up that everyone was in everyone's business.
Yeah.
That part would get old sometimes. Like, I remember specifically not loving that when my parents were getting a divorce. Like,
right.
Everyone was like,
how are you?
Yeah, like, everyone was in the business and gossiping about it and talking about, "Did you hear my son?" I guess this was early on. Like, my parents divorced when it was pretty taboo to get divorced.
So did they consciously uncouple?
They sure did.
Oh, they were friendly?
No. Oh. They're very friendly now. They're very tight, but it took a while to get to a comfortable place. But
how,
you know,
how old were you again?
I was 12.
So no one in your class had divorced parents?
No. I mean, I was like, we were OG divorced family, and I felt like our family and my mother kind of had this like scarlet letter on us.
Yeah.
Because and nobody even knew you were gay yet.
No, I didn't have to deal with that yet. So my outsider was that, divorced parents. Because all of my friends' parents are, to this day, a lot of them are still together that I grew up with. And so I remember, feeling bad for my mom back then that she kind of was an outsider all of a sudden in that way. Because it there and women kind of were, you know, when they would hear a woman divorce, is like another friend of ours, their parents got divorced kind of soon after. And so my mom and that lady became like good friends because they were like, "Well, it's the two of us now against the world."
It's like me with other vegans.
My mom said there was always kind of this vibe from other women that like, here come those ladies, like they're gonna, you know, they would like hold on to their husbands tighter, like,
oh my god,
they know they're coming in and swooping in around on their man. I'm like, my mom is not swooping in on your man, calm down.
That's hilarious.
That's also like when somebody dies and then all the ladies, like, some guy's single, he's widowed.
Yeah.
They all head over and bring some food and try and get in there on that open spot.
My mom had a suitor at one point who kind of did look down on her that she was a divorcee.
No. Mm-hmm. Wait, but he was suiting her. So what?
I know, but he ended up breaking up.
He couldn't help himself.
He ended up breaking up with her to go out with a widow.
That was like more acceptable.
That was more like,
and again, he didn't know that you were gay.
That would have been a big problem. It's so wild to me but he thought that the widow needed him more.
Oh
and
my
god. It's like such an old school mentality. And obviously in today's time, there's way more it's way more common. That's just a part of society now. But back then it was like such a thing.
I love picturing this guy thinking he's such a catch and like,
oh yeah, I gotta look after this poor widow.
I'm picturing him looking like the guy on the Monopoly game for some reason. Like he's like,
and that all of these women need his help. He's like, all right, I've helped Ginger. Now I'm going to go help this widow. Yeah. How long did she date him?
Two or three years, maybe.
Oh.
Three years, maybe.
Oh, wow.
So
oh,
a chunk of time.
A chunk
of
time.
Not just like three dates and then was I can't deal with this divorce.
He would take her on dates like away, like kind of on the outskirts of town.
Oh no, that's so bad.
Yes, because he didn't want his Baptist friends to know that, you know, that he was dating a divorcee, and then like so old school that he wouldn't even like drink wine or anything at in restaurants in town. Like he would only do it if they were at the place where they he wouldn't be seen. It was
what a loser.
Very old school. So yeah, that part of small town was like so antiquated to me, you know. Even I was like, what are we doing here? This is wild.
I mean, I've had that I mean, like from dating closeted people, it came into my mind that one birthday, this woman who I was dating and lived with, who didn't want any of her friends to know, she was like, let's go to this, like, it was Kew Gardens, which is like way on the outskirts of London. And I was definitely, because no one would bump into, because I was like, let's go into Soho and have dinner. She's like, I'd like to go over to this garden really far away. And I had no interest in gardens. And then we got there and she was so, sort of tired and sleepy that she rented a wheelchair from the entrance.
What?
And and I ended up just pushing her around this garden all day.
And I can't believe this relationship didn't work out.
I know. I pushed her around the garden and then and then got back and had to pretend to be her buddy at home with our roommate. I was like, what do I do? It was the moment as I was pushing the wheelchair, that's sort of when it all started to, I thought,
I would hope so.
Yeah.
Something's wrong here.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is quite right.
The stuff you put up with, like, I was like 28 years old. I wasn't, ridiculous.
Well, should we see what Rachel Dratch has to say about her hometown?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Wherever that is. Does anyone know where she's from?
Boston?
No, I couldn't tell
maybe.
You.
Boston?
I don't know. I'm guessing.
Okay.
I'm guessing Chicago. That's a guess.
Hello, I had a set and a costume change for my answer to the question. So I was thinking about this. So I grew up in Massachusetts in a town called Lexington. And when I think about what I loved about my hometown, the first thing I think of is the natural beauty that I sort of took for granted, I think, growing up. I think of walking to school in the fall and kicking leaves the whole way to school and the smell of the leaves. Or I think of a snow day and lifting up my window shade and seeing everything covered with white with the trees looking so pretty. And it always smelled so good, too. So that's what I really miss about my hometown. And then I live in New York City now, so you can see why I might miss some natural beauty. And then the other things I would say is, I started out when I was 5 there, so I have friends from when I was 5 years old. And I did like high school, so I like going back. I feel connected to my high school classmates. And then the third thing I'd say is the Boston area has this sort of like intellectual bent with all the colleges there, but then it also has a kind of a sardonic wit, I think, is valued there. So, you know, your cabbie, your the cook at the burger joint, there's sort of, I think humor is sort of valued there, and maybe it is everywhere, I don't know, but it's sort of, I don't know, you just, I think it's sort of in the air there. Maybe that's my imagination. Maybe that shaped me. I don't know. That's just my vibe about it. So anyway, that's what I liked about my hometown, handsome. What did you like about yours? Or what didn't you like? I'm sure I've already... Okay, that. Sorry, cut this part. Okay, what do you like about yours?
I was thinking Boston because she and Fallon used to do those Boston characters all the time. You remember?
Yes. Yeah.
And would go real hard. They played like high school boyfriend, girlfriend, and would do the like accent really hard, like super hardcore. Boston.
I do think some Boston and like some places are funny. Like have a cultural identity of like Liverpool is like that. Mm-hmm. Like everyone's funny. Dublin. I think Boston does have that.
Well, that accent, so like it sounds so
it's funny.
Cartoony. Mm-hmm. Park the car. Humor.
Sardonic, but I one time was watching a roast battle at Just for Laughs, and then somebody made a joke about an aorta, and I just hear these two guys next to me, and one of them goes, what's an aorta? And the other one goes, it's a part of your heart.
A part of your heart.
Oh, my God. You didn't know what an aorta was?
Yeah. I always remember.
Part of your heart.
It's a part of your heart.
It's a part of your heart. That is so great.
That is so funny.
That is.
Well, that's awesome. It is kind of wild that she asked about hometowns, because so much of my childhood was me watching Saturday Night Live, mm-hmm, and memorizing the sketches. Same. From her, definitely her cast and yeah, others, and going to school to like practice and stuff and reciting those sketches. Yeah. Like yeah, she is a part of
your
my
childhood.
Hometown experience. Yeah. So
that's amazing.
It's trippy.
Yeah.
That's so great.
Yeah. All right. Well, make sure you check out our website, handsomepod.com. Get your merch. We have some fun things in there. Some things you're going to want
on your body. Yeah, rep the pod out in the world, out in your hometown. Rep the pod.
Yeah.
Rep the pod, and also rate the pod and subscribe to the pod and send an episode to a friend, and let's build our handsome community, shall we?
A reminder, you can watch the pod on YouTube if you're a visually minded person. You can see me getting tased, acting that out.
Yes.
I've got no live shows coming up. I'm still filming and stuff, but you can check out Feel Good on Netflix or my special Sap on Netflix. What about you guys?
November 16th, the very last show of my tour. I just added it. Santa Rosa, California.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Tig, your friend, will be in Kansas City on November 2nd and St. Louis on November 15th. And I'm also in Toronto working out new material at Comedy Bar. So get your tickets. And then also, if you're in LA, check out Largo and Dynasty Typewriter, because I'm also working out new material there when I'm back in town.
And every Friday, Pretty Little Episodes. Don't
yes,
forget to tune
pretty
in.
Pretty Little Episodes, and send your questions and answers in for your chance to be on a Pretty Little Episode.
Mm-hmm.
Thomas said those are doing really well, that they're popular right out of the gate.
I love that.
Yeah, it's really, really fun. So, yep, thanks for listening. Until next time, I mean, what should they do? What should we all do?
We should keep it handsome.
Home shopping season is here. That means you're on the lookout for new home insurance, whether you're new to the market or an existing homeowner. Allstate can save you time and money on your home insurance policy.
Check Allstate first, and you could save $574 on your home insurance. No hassle, just savings. You're in good hands with Allstate.
Not available in every state. Based on the national average annual savings for new home insurance customers surveyed in 2023 who switched to Allstate and reported savings. Savings vary.